Welcome along, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Hiral Dadhia. We have with us Adhish Patil, CFO at Aarti Drugs, joining me on the show. Welcome to the show, Adhish. It's a pleasure having you as well. My first question coming to you right now is, I mean, enough that we've spoken about how COVID has impacted different industries right now. Pharma as a sector overall, if you go to see, have seen a positive impact, you know, in terms of COVID, which is a blessing in disguise. And that's clearly seen from how the quarter has been from the company. It has been a spectacular quarter as well in terms of the results. If you could just help us understand first, what has worked for Aarti Drugs right now?
Yes. Actually, though last 2 years were quite subdued for us in terms of margins because of shortages in RM from China, if you remember correctly, in 2017-18. But by the end of FY19-20, we were able to improve those efficiencies starting from new RMs, new KSM. And the same thing has continued in June quarter. Fortunately, unlike most of the other companies, we were able to maintain very high production efficiency. And because of this Chinese competition going down during the COVID period, a lot of API prices have gone up. That has really helped us in improving the gross margins, and which can be seen in EBITDA and the PAT margins as well.
Right. So overall, if you want to see right now, in terms of the numbers as well, what is the kind of growth opportunity are you seeing from here on? Are you expecting this kind of performance to continue in the coming quarters as well?
As far as the demand is concerned, we feel it is quite sustainable and it is there for long. As far as prices are concerned, they might soften a little. But what we have observed at till date, except for a couple of products, most of the prices are still higher. And what we have seen that is from the product portfolio of say 20-30 products, almost 90% of the products, the prices are high. It is not like one-off product, the prices have gone up. It is across the board. So we feel that based on the fact that last 2 years back, there was one structural change, means a lot of Chinese company closed down due to pollution issues. And most of the global players started, become afraid that they need to have second sources, Indian sources as well. And just in within the span of 2 years, again, this thing, COVID-19 has happened. Again, there was disruption of supplies from most of the Chinese companies. So this will motivate the MNCs even more to procure more and more from Indian sources. So we feel that this is a structural change and it is there for long.
Right. So then basically, are we trying to say that the disruption that we've seen on the back of China, on the, you know, in terms of where APIs is concerned, that is one of the major factors that is driving growth for companies like yours?
Correct.
Right. And with this, if you see in terms of where the API business goes, you mentioned earlier as well, your realizations have been higher on APIs, and that's what has actually led to the gross margin expansion as well. Now, the prices have risen by almost around 10 to 15%, if I'm not mistaken. Do you think that price rise is something which is sustainable? And if yes, for how long and by when do you see prices coming back to levels of what, you know, companies would be procuring earlier from China?
Right. Now, the thing, it's very difficult. The market situation is very dynamic as of now. As of today, the prices are still higher. So we feel that maybe in December or March quarter, there might be some kind of relaxation in prices. But even we are not sure at this point of time that how the things will pan out.
Okay. And overall right now, do you see the share of APIs increasing in your business portfolio right now from your own?
Yeah, so the June quarter, the API component was around 79%. Our intermediate and specialty was around 6% and formulation was around 15%. Traditionally, last 3 years, the formulation was around 10%. Now it has inched up to 15% because of very good export demand. The API segment and specialty intermediate is also showing very good prospects in future. So they will also grow. So what we feel that current the proportions what we have in different segments, they will continue to remain more or less similar for next couple of years.
Okay. And are you expecting share of antibiotics to increase?
Not really. Maybe in a short span, possibly because of the higher utilization of the existing capacities, but most of the CapEx what we are doing is all non-antibiotic related, more like cardiovascular and anti-diabetic, anti-inflammatory, pain management, those kind of segments.
Okay. So overall, at what capacity utilization are we functioning with regards to where the API facilities go?
Yes. So last year we closed around 76% utilization, and more or less it is similar for June quarter as well.
Okay, but are you expecting an increase on that front? And if yes, at what capacity do you think the company will need to incur a capex on the API side?
So I would say right from today is our capex is already on for this year as well. We lost 3-4 months because of this lockdown. The things were quite slow as far as the construction of new projects were concerned. Though we'll be completing one of the projects which we started back in Q4 FY20, it will get completed in August end or mid-September. And we feel that this year, because of the delayed start of the CapEx cycle, we might incur less than 100 crore of CapEx. But for going 3-4 years, we do have plans for around 300 to 400 crores of CapEx.
Right. And with this, we have the government which has come out and, you know, given out the production-linked 100 billion rupees incentive schemes. Now, that is something which could be benefiting companies like yours as well. What's the plan on that front?
Yes. So, the government has listed 41 products, partly fermentation, then intermediates and APIs, chemical APIs as well. A lot of the products which are listed in that overlaps with our product line from the top 10 products, I would say. So it's good that government has identified these products as import substitutes. Mm-hmm. Now at RPW, we always have that strategy in last 5-6 years to introduce import substitute products, and we were very successful in doing so till date. So the fact that PLI scheme have incorporated those products, we are very hopeful that this is going to be beneficial for us, even if not directly, but indirectly, because in presentations which we attended from government, one of the industry asked the question that suppose they go in for PLI, they invest in CapEx, but then China starts dumping in the product, then what happens? So government said that don't worry, we will take care of that dumping through other methods like raising the customs duty, so anti-dumping duty kind of thing. So even if that happens, it will be very helpful for margins for our product line. And definitely as far as direct benefit is concerned, we will be applying for, we have identified 4-5 products for the PLI scheme.
But by when do you see this will actually reflect on the financials? How, what's the kind of timeline we should be working with?
Yeah, so next 4 months, I think we have time to file in with the applications, the detailed project reports. Then another three months government will take to evaluate whom to allot the, means each product they will be selecting few manufacturers who will be applicable for the PLI scheme. So, and then they have given 1.5 years time to construct the products as far as construct the projects as far as the chemical products are concerned, chemical synthesis.
Right.
So at one and a half years.
Okay. And do you think there are opportunities for contract manufacturing as well on this front?
I didn't get a question. In what sense?
Will RT drugs undertake contract manufacturing also?
For this production PLI scheme process?
Yes.
No. So, as far as PLI scheme is concerned, then we will be investing on our own.
Okay. No, but I'm saying that, you know, basically, there are a lot of specialty products as well that were earlier manufactured in China, right? So, taking that into consideration, if another brand comes to you saying that, okay, manufacture for us, will you be open to something like that?
Okay. Yeah. So, I misinterpreted the question earlier. The thing is, there are few opportunities where we are looking. In past also, we have successfully done tie-ups with a few of the MNCs to manufacture a particular intermediate for them. And we are in talks with a few other companies as well. So, this is one of the areas which we are quite open to, and we look forward to doing such contract manufacturing, especially in the intermediate and specialty chemical space.
Okay. And with regards to the formulations business source, again, the demand has been higher from institutional clients. Are you expecting this up move to continue, or do you think this is just a temporary phase?
For formulations, the exports, the major growth for us is in exports, and that will continue to be so. We have a very strong order book also, pending order book for exports, and we are launching more and registering more and more products across different geographies. So more and more markets will open up. So the growth shall continue for formulations.
Okay. And overall, in terms of the business operations as well, any issues on the supply side? How does the distribution model work for the APIs and the formulation business for RP?
Okay. So as far as COVID-19 related issues are concerned, we are not facing any as of now. Earlier, maybe in the month of April, we were facing few. So our production efficiency was slightly lower in 60s, but then we were able to take it up a lot higher in the month of May and June. So disruptions are not there. As far as supply chain is concerned for API segment, we sell to a lot of end users directly, and some of it through digital business also as well, depending upon how fragmented the market is. As far as formulations are concerned, we have multiple models in formulation. Distributor based models are also there. Then toll manufacturing based model is also there. So there are multiple models in formulation. In some cases, we have done 50-50 partnership with the distributors to launch a particular product in the regulated market as well.
Okay. So overall, are we trying to say that we would be able to maintain, say, almost around 20-22% kind of EBITDA margin profile for FY21? And secondly, what's the kind of revenue growth are we expecting?
So we are hoping that we'll be closing FY2021 with a consolidated revenue growth of around 20-25%. But the bottom line growth should be much larger than that. So at the bottom is a net profit after tax. We are hoping anywhere between 70-90% growth for the entire year.
Okay. And are you seeing any risks which will actually probably impact the guidance?
Risks are quite lower because we are quite conservative with our guidance. Rather than conservative, I would say we are more realistic. So we feel that this is the most probable case.
Right. So that's something we should be watching out for as well. But thank you so much, Adish, for joining us on the show. It was a pleasure speaking to you. I hope you enjoyed the interaction as well, and we will see you soon. And stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.